Judicial corruption undermines the fabric of society. If the police routinely take bribes and court officials are for sale to the highest bidder, then justice is put beyond the reach of ordinary people and no one can trust the law. But as this Africa Investigates expose makes clear, that's exactly what's happening in Uganda.
Kampala is the capital and largest city of Uganda. Home to over 1.5 million people, it buzzes with joys and woes. My name is Emmanuel Mutaiziwa. As an investigative journalist, my job is to get under the skin of the stories that drive this city and expose the truth behind many of the challenges that we face.
In Uganda today, the media is full of stories about corruption, which has permeated every aspect of life, including health, education, and roads. In this film, I'll be investigating allegations that corruption has crept into one of the most sacred institutions in the land.
Recent reports from Transparency International and Uganda's own Inspectorate of Government have pointed to worrying practices in Uganda's magistrate courts. Sadly, they now join a long list of public institutions perceived to be corrupt.
Now I want to show you how corruption is widespread in this country. We're right here at the outskirts of Kampala at Owino Market, and we're going to seek the opinions of the locals who work in this market. And you hear the word from the horse's mouth.
When you are not aware of, as you have stated, you can't get justice. I can't hear you say there is no corruption in justice. It is typically there.
Those who are well off can get lawyers, can bribe and get whatever they want.
Favors are given to the high income earners, people with money, people with the necessary resources, to at least to bail out their cases. That's the standard of the judiciary case in Uganda.
People seem resigned to corruption as a part of everyday life. The only way we will ever eradicate this ill is if the perpetrators are caught in the act, named and shamed. I'm making my way to Kasangati, a suburb north of Kampala. I'm going to meet two men who may be able to help me expose graft.
I first heard about these two gentlemen, Mr. Katimbo and Luyombia, about 6 months ago because of their activism in seeing that corruption is exposed in courts of laws.
This is Matthias Katimbo and Pastor Daniel Luyombia. We meet at the new church that they are building. There have been compelling complaints against the judiciary, which they are taking to the authorities. I want to know what prompted them to become anti-corruption activists.
One time I was sued, and I saw the corruption in that court, which prompted me to, you know, to dig out that seed of corruption at Kasangati Court.
How did you manage to gather these complaints?
We were lucky at one moment to be victims. We learned the hard way. Then we realized, if this can happen to us, what about those who are less informed? Then we chose to scout and spy on this magician, see if it's happening to others. And we realized it was a day-to-day activity.
The lives of a whole community are affected by this court. I want to find out how this corruption works and just how widespread this practice is. The next day, I'm back in Kasangati to meet more complainants.
So early this morning, we set out to go and talk to these people and get that very personal story from them. We've been told that a number of them have been asked to pay for bribes, which amounts to paying for justice.
Each paid 2 million.
2 million, yes.
When did they take the money?
It was March.
All these people have been involved in criminal proceedings. Court clerks insisted they must pay a cash sum or face jail until their hearings. This is a fraudulent use of bail money, as payment is only necessary if they are accused absconds from the hearing.
How frequent does this happen?
Does it?
Yes.
Almost every day. Even as I speak now, if I go today, I can put in another case. where money is changing hands. They are habitual offenders.
Early this morning, we arrived here at Kasangati through our sources, Mr. Dan Luyobia and Matthias Katimbo. They managed to gather a number of litigants who revealed it all pointed to one thing, Kasangati Court.
In 2013, the Kasangati Magistrate Court was investigated by the Anti-Corruption Coalition Uganda. As a result, a number of court clerks were fired and a magistrate was transferred. But I think something fishy is still going on. Methods of corruption can be sly and subtle. To catch this practice red-handed, I will need some covert tactics. I'm going to launch an undercover sting, so I have assembled a team of trusted friends. Investigative journalist Richard Wanambwa, health and safety expert Moses Zinga, Tom Muchibi, a journalist and documentary filmmaker, Ivan Okuda, just 21, but already responsible for some major stories, and Derek Lufunya, a human rights lawyer. Our plan is to present a case to the police. One of us will pose as a complainant, claiming he's been sold a plot of land that in fact doesn't exist.
We want to pretend like we bought a piece of land, and after the purchaser buying the land from the vendor disappears. And the only person we can trace is a broker.
We want to make it look as if the agreement was between the vendor and the purchaser. And the broker was a witness.
A witness.
But at the point, at the point where money exchanged hands, it's the broker that received the what? The money.
Richard will play the buyer.
So I can actually go report this case to Kasangati tomorrow.
With a secret, but when you're going to do that, we want you to go, because for purposes of showing evidence, with a secret camera. The broker is the important role now. Yeah. Moses says he will be the broker. And he lives in that place.
I have to talk to my dad and tell him it is a pledge, because if anything happens, he will not get worried.
A lot has to fall into place for our scheme to work, and I'm responsible for a plan that could land one of my team in jail. Richard and I travel to the Kasangati police station. He'll kick off the sting by reporting our fake land dispute. We've already worried that the police will smell a rat, but it becomes apparent they are more interested in something else.
Finding Nyamba. Nyamba, we trust this man. Yeah? How much? How much? Ah, isn't in the neighborhood. How much?
The policewoman is called Officer Nagai. She will help trace the missing land vendor, but only for a price.
Oh, wait.
Cutting, cause it? I've done 60. I've done 70. Nay.
Just as so many regular people have described to me, the road to justice begins with a payment.
Okay, since I have your number, I will be the call.
Look at this. She picks the money and folds it quickly.
I review the footage with Moses. As we are claiming that the vendor is in hiding, it will be Moses' turn to go undercover next. He plays the part of the land broker.
Are you quite nervous about this whole ordeal?
Yeah, there is some quite of nervousness. You can't completely rule it out because, you know, our system, any small flaw could lead you to spending 5 days in prison.
Two days go by and the police don't contact Moses.
So we decide he should head to Kasangati police station and turn himself in. Ivan accompanies him wearing a covert camera. He will also put up bail should they try to arrest Moses.
Moses. Where is it?
So I've decided to come just to show that.
You are so loyal.
No, I'm innocent.
Moses gives his side of the story. An officer suggests he should be detained, but luckily Ivan is there to pay the bail.
Nearly put me to a cell. To a cell.
Things are getting hot, eh?
I was just like this.
The next step is for the police to bring the case to court. We now must let the mechanism of the law take its turn, but again, it will probably need some greasing. The following day, Richard is summoned to the police station. The land dispute is now classed as fraud, a criminal offense. Richard meets a CIID officer. His name is Geoffrey Kotek. Kotek will take Richard to meet the state attorney, a public officer who will act as the prosecutor in his case.
They had decided 200.
We can go there.
Okay. The man was standing there, following the.
Now I buy the envelope.
Okay,
let me buy the envelope and come back.
As a public officer, the state attorney shouldn't require any cash payment. But after buying the envelope, Richard goes to his car. Detective Kotek and the officer Nagai are his passengers.
For balance is 100. Okay. Yeah.
Richard gives 100,000 shillings to Kotek, a second sum of 50,000 shillings to Officer Nagai, and places 200,000 shillings, that's about $80, in the envelope.
I give you.
Richard hands the envelope to Detective Kotek. They all travel together to the Kasangati court. On arrival, both officers accompany Richard into the office of the state attorney, Rachel Bikole.
Good morning, madam. Richard.
As a publicly funded lawyer, it's the state attorney's job to represent plaintiffs. Kotek explains the case to her, but suddenly asks Richard to wait outside.
That's okay.
From outside the door, Richard points his secret camera into the office. He captures at the exact moment when the CID officer hands the state attorney an envelope. To us, it looks identical to the envelope that Richard earlier filled with money. But of course, we can't verify that without blowing our cover. So we're dependent on video evidence and the word of all persons involved. We contacted the state attorney, Rachel Bikole. She told us she has never demanded money to sanction a case file, and the envelope that Kotek handed her that day contained a letter detailing another case. She told us this was her very first meeting with Detective Kotek, and that subsequently the officer did not submit the case file. She added that it's a common occurrence that persons interested in unlawfully taking money from litigants claim the resident state attorney has demanded for the same. We also contacted Detective Kotek for his side of the story. So far, we've had no response from him. We decided to withdraw our fake land dispute. The chances of Moses going to jail just became too great. But our investigation into corruption at Kasangati Court
is not over. You must remember that there's a hierarchy to this corruption. Now, we're currently on our way to meet someone who might help us unravel graft at the highest level.
The big fish at court are rarely charged with corruption. Many people suspect they protect themselves through lower-ranking intermediaries. But I'm meeting a man who may have a direct access to a magistrate. Asuman is facing charges of malicious damage to property. He claims they are false and that his opponents are bribing court officials to prosecute him.
Musango guno guli ku poroti se nange je yawo mwana wange ere baruwa jola biekawo ye yave watata wafatu zala no yumanye naji ye yali ekakasa poroti eno ani nanyini yo.
Asuman's sister owned a plot of land adjacent to his. 2 years ago she fell ill and died. Her boyfriend blamed Asuman and summoned the mob.
No, mwami na kunga abantu na abategeza nti nagula amayembe gegatani mwanyinaze. Era mwami kenyini oyo jiso na kunga abantu nebayo kya maka gange.
Asuman was chased from his land and his late sister's house was occupied by people associated with her boyfriend. Asuman pressed charges of arson against them. Eventually the case was quashed and the accused launched a counter case against Asuman. He believes the magistrate was bribed, and 2 days ago, he went to meet him. These are very serious allegations that I need to verify. At the moment, all I have is Asuman's word against that of a very powerful man. To further my investigation against this magistrate, I need to learn more about Asuman's case, so I return to Kasangati. This is the land in dispute. The house belonged to Asuman's late sister. The rubble is all that's left of his home.
Enzimba wano, ekibanja kinene, akirimu eka zinga tano. Zinzali endabirwamu, ezali madinisa n'enziji.
Asuman and his family now live a few miles away in two small rooms.
Bintu bicha nemi okoza. Yona ba byocha.
Anje kali mu chintu chano chimutwala. Mange ntebe zali ntebe za bei, sai ndio obulindi chibyo ne byali mu byayirone. Kale tuna cha tata sawa dechi.
Kali embera yo gendimu yo sinungi kupakati n'abaana abakulu abasoma nabajja eno olw'okuba nti sikyasobola kubaweerera mu kibuga muno.
To get his life back, Asuman feels he has no choice but to pay for justice. So he has resolved to give the magistrate the little money he has in the hope he'll be cleared of the current charges and then be able to claim his land back. But before he goes into court, I fit Asuman with a covert camera and give him some training in its use. Given the nature of the camera, it's pretty difficult to capture a transaction.
When he stands straight, there's a chance that perhaps he could miss that very important handshake. But when he bends, there's a likelihood that he gets him.
We also give Asuman two of these yellow 50,000 shilling notes. He places them in his top left pocket.
Wanga jivatu isi zamu, zi kuruwangi kati nje ndi omu, ni eva anja wakava kuwa.
Everything now depends on Asuman. He's not a trained journalist, and we've just one shot at this. Asuman told me that the magistrate asked him to come into court today to bring a document detailing his complaint against the men on his land and to bring the bribe money. This is his worship, Richard Okoth. He is a grade 2 magistrate. That's the document that details Asuman's complaint. He told me yesterday that the magistrate instructed him to bring as much money as he could. He now has 100,000 shillings
in his jacket pocket. Asuman now hands over two folded 50,000 shilling notes. Although we have Asuman's word that Okoth requested this bribe, I think that evidence is strong enough to take to the authorities.
We are going to show the inspector of government, a high court judge herself, Justice Irene Mulyagonja, and we're going to show her clips with incriminating evidence of what we've been able to film through our undercover investigation.
Justice Irene Mulyagonja heads the Inspectorate of Government, an independent institution mandated to eliminate corruption and the abuse of public office.
Now, this is the magistrate at the court. Were you told which grade this magistrate is?
Grade 2.
The grade 2 magistrate. Okay. Section 2 of the Anti-Corruption Act prohibits public officers or any person from taking gratification or asking for gratification in return for a service. Unfortunately, in most cases, the report is made after the bribe has been given. This rent taking in public institutions cuts across the board. Every place where public service is being provided by government, it's a public officer, he has committed a crime, and he should be prosecuted.
I'm satisfied that with my video evidence, Justice Irene's office can launch a fresh investigation. But I also want to hear what the police say about their officers.
It's quite unfortunate that you can see a police lady really taking a bribe just to enter a case. That is a conduct, of course, that we do condemn. Under such circumstances, we are going to serve her with a suspension later, pending investigation. And now with this very incident, our professional standards unit will definitely move in and you'll get to see results.
Reprimanding a few officials may seem like a drop in the ocean in the face of Uganda's endemic corruption. But to feed their greed, these officials have been robbing this community for years. So I'm excited to reveal the success of our investigation to the people that really kick-started it.
Very promising.
Hey,
that's what I told you. Sometimes these people are letting us down. Maybe the judiciary, or like possibly they've got a good fathers there. And they try to protect him all the time.
I'm so happy because those are the people who has given us burden.
In response to our allegations, Magistrate Okoth admitted to receiving a sum of cash, but he insists the money came from the clerk and was passed to him through Asuman. As long as ordinary Ugandans have little faith in their public servants, they'll look for justice elsewhere. Through our undercover investigation, we have been able to expose corruption within Uganda's magistrates' courts and be able to take it to the country's highest authorities. But I really have to hand it to people like Katimbo, Luyombi, and Asuman. Without their efforts, we could not have achieved much. As Ugandans, we must commend them for their brave fight of freeing this country from the shackles of corruption and bringing down the temples of injustice.